You familiar with that one, Trey? I thought it would be appropriate to open the show with that.
I know it. Couldn't tell you the name of it. I know it though. I do know it.
Beckhole son. I can't really hit the notes. I'll blow up my vocal cords if I try to do it. I thought we should open with Black Hole Sun because, I mean, shoot, out of anything that we talked about last week, the eclipse was certainly a hot button issue with a lot of people out there. There were people in the comments that were like, I don't give a shit about the eclipse. And it's like, okay, fine, whatever. Trent, I saw pictures that you put on social media. Obviously, I drove down to Ohio, the state of Ohio, albeit I was there very briefly. It was an in and out operation. I'm curious. When we talked about this last week, you were like, you didn't really get it. And you know that the hotels were going for a lot of money. And you just, you know, you were like, yeah, I'll watch it. You were in the complete shadow, if I'm not mistaken, right? Yes. You were in 100% yes. coverage. Was that the first time you had seen it that way?
Yeah, it was.
What were your thoughts on that experience?
It was absolutely sweet. It was very surreal. It was definitely something that I'm happy that I got to experience. However,
no, don't ruin it with a however. Come on. We were doing so good.
I would not pay $400 or $500 to go watch it for 5 minutes.
You know what? I think that's fair. I think it's fair. I wouldn't do that either. And to be honest, when I did it back in 2017, we didn't do that. When I did it this time, we didn't do it. I mean, we literally drove, we were maybe, I don't know, 10 miles south of Toledo, like off the highway in a random, like I had no idea where we were going when we piled in the car. I found like this kind of like small town off the highway. And then we pulled off and we found this little turn in into a field where, like, I don't know if somebody owned it. I had no idea what the case was. So like there was no plan. It didn't cost any money. I agree with you, Trent. I don't know that I would, maybe if I knew that it was going to be a once in a lifetime thing, and I wanted to go get a hotel and, you know, different circumstances. Maybe you're a little bit older. Maybe you want the convenience of having a hotel. Then maybe I could justify it. But money aside, the actual experience of being able to see it, I agree with you. And I felt it the first time I saw it. And I certainly felt it this time that, like, when it starts to happen, when you get really close to where you're in the complete shadow, like, you look around and everything kind of feels like you're in a dream a little bit. Like there, you know, it's not normal dusk. It's like a different type of darkness that you feel. And then once that shadow hits and you look up at the sky, I heard some guys talking about this at the media availability today, or maybe it was the last one on Wednesday. I can't remember. But you know, what humans must have thought way back in the day before like science was a thing and before we knew what the hell was going on. Like you look up in the sky and you see that image, it must have been, I mean, it's no wonder that people, you know, that where maybe things like religion come from, or you think, you know, there's some sort of thing up there watching you. Like it is an incredible experience that is hard to define. And like I said, before it happened, 99% versus 100%, it's a totally different experience. And I know that, Trent, because I took my glasses off real quick at 99% and I felt like the sun rays went directly into my retina.
Yeah.
It was very difficult to see for maybe 30 seconds before I got my sight back.
I did the same thing and I was like, man, it's so hard to believe it's actually that bright. Like it was basically at 99%. It's like, oh my gosh.
It's like crazy, it's, right?
It's still super bright. And then once it went to 100, it was crazy. It was awesome.
Yeah. This black hole up in the sky that you stare at. And it's just, it's a really unique experience. So Trent, I'm glad you got to experience that. And for anybody out there who got to experience it, you know, kudos to you because it's just such an incredible thing and it's not going to happen again for like what? Another, I don't know, 20 years or so, or something like that. I'm not sure when the next one is, but it's going to be a while away.
I think the next one in Ohio is like 2088 or something like
Yeah. Like it's a while, like there's a different path for the next one. And I think it kind of goes through California. Somebody was saying it's going to be the most expensive day Disney ticket ever recorded, which I'm sure of it. So get ready for that. Start saving for that one, Trent. I know that you're a Disney guy. You can't wait to get out.
Yeah. I'm saving right now. Penny a day.
But we are, hey, we're in episode 10 of you and I doing the show here. And I think, you know, where we were when we first started trying to kind of figure out and get our footing and find what our groove is. I don't know, man. We're 10 episodes in. How are you feeling after 10 episodes of doing a show together? You seem to feel more confident, more comfortable what you're doing.
Yeah, I didn't even realize we were at number 10 until you mentioned that before we went live. Awesome.
Yeah,
I think. Yeah, I mean, like. The first one that we did together, I mean, I've done a few episodes before, but
yeah,
the first one you and I did together, I'm like, okay, what do I say? Like, how do I do this? And and then it's like, okay, yeah, we're just talking football like two friends do. And it's
pretty good. When it's you and I, like before we go live and we just sit and we talk or whatever, but it's different when you're live. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's different when there's people
commenting and they're like,
correct,
talking about things you're saying. It's a little different.
It is a little bit different, but I'm happy that we're 10 episodes, man. It's been a pleasure doing the shows with you. And then I saw somebody mention it in the comments tonight, just to do a little housekeeping. Yes, Michigan is in the Frozen Four tonight. I think they play at, what, 8 or 8:30 tonight. So, you know, best of luck to them. It would be nice to see another Michigan team wearing the winged helmet capture a national championship. I know that I'm going to be tuning in. Trent, I don't know if you're going to be tuning in because you've got some things going on late that we'll talk about in a little bit, but I'm certainly going to be watching the game. And then I also saw, you know, saw a lot of reaction to this today. OJ Simpson, you know, is no longer with us. He's passed away. I just thought it was interesting when the news broke, you know. Obviously, this guy has had a history, you know, a history in the NFL, history in college. I mean, he's done a lot of different things, and everything that I could see on TV was like him and the white Bronco going down the highway. And I feel like when my time comes, I hope that, if there's some notoriety there, like fine, whatever. But I hope there's just not a memory of me driving in a white Bronco with, you know, 25 police cars chasing me. That was all I could see. I mean, Trent, when you heard the news, did it affect you in a certain way? Were you an OJ Simpson fan? You might be a little bit too young for that at 30.
No, it didn't really have a whole lot of effect on me. I will say that I turned on ESPN for like 10 minutes today, and the whole thing was about him in the courtroom, the gloves don't fit type of thing, yeah. And the Bronco going down the road. If it doesn't fit,
you must acquit. Yes, and look, I think what people were talking about was how that was like. That was the first real sort of reality show that people were exposed to in America. And there were certain networks that covered it from the very beginning to the verdict. And I feel like the country was hanging on, you know, every single thing that was happening in that trial. So, I mean, regardless of how you feel about OJ Simpson, obviously he was, you know, a big figure in American history, pop culture maybe is the way to put it. But, you know, the news broke today that he's no longer with us. So, you know, thoughts and prayers to his family. And the other thing I want to mention before we get into our show, Trent, is dude, this sign, this Detroit sign, that was supposed to be the spectacular sign leading folks into the NFL draft in downtown Detroit, is getting a lot of blowback. And I'm a little bit disappointed that I don't have a picture of it to put up on the screen. Have you seen the sign?
No.
The Detroit sign? It was supposed to look like the Hollywood sign, and the rendering showed these massive letters spelling out Detroit off the highway, welcoming people into the city. And if you look at the pictures of what it actually turned out to be, it's extremely underwhelming. I'm sure there's probably some people. Yeah, there's some people out there that can send it in. The Temu edition. I've heard people equate it to they ordered it off of Wish, which I've never gone that route before. But apparently, if you order something off of Wish, it's absolutely terrible. But very underwhelming sign.
That.
Well, it was supposed to be that. Can you pull up Detroit? Oh, there you go. Yeah,
to the bottom.
See, that's how small it is. I couldn't even see it down there.
That's terrible.
It's terrible. Yeah. So that's getting dragged through the mud. Pretty disappointed to see that, especially when you saw what the renderings were, what was promised to the fans, but still exciting to have the draft coming up in Detroit. I'm going to try to make it down there at the end of April. Are you going to try to make it up for that? I know it's going to be a bit of a hike for you. Any interest of coming to the draft? Or are you going to watch it from the...
I think I'm going to sit on my couch and watch it.
That's not a bad alternative either. Let's get right into it. We'll talk about this week's media availability. And we had some pretty key players step to the podium this week and some coaches. And it started with Tony Elford on Wednesday. He was joined by Lamar Morgan. They're obviously both two new coaches to the staff. But I think everybody was looking at Tony Elford and very interested to see what he was going to say. I mean, here's a guy who spent nearly a decade in Columbus as a running backs coach with Ohio State. And now he's wearing the maize and blue. And interestingly enough, like even when he was standing at the podium, I looked down at his shoes and they were like the canvas on them was gray and the laces had like a red to them. So he was talking about his wardrobe and how he's trying to make sure he doesn't wear any scarlet and gray into the Michigan facilities. Because
I saw that he said that he wouldn't have any Ohio State clothes in Michigan.
I mean, but dude, when you're there for a decade, like I noticed his shoes, I was like, that looks a little bit Buckeye-ish. I didn't bring it up, but I thought, you know, if there was anybody looking for any sort of juicy soundbite from Tony Elford that he was going to say something, maybe, you know, to sort of poke at Ohio State, like that was not going to happen on Wednesday. He went to the podium and I'll be honest, and I think I said this in the article I put out, it was actually a little bit difficult as somebody who's a fan of Michigan and hates Ohio State to listen to a Michigan coach talk about Ohio State in such a positive way. I mean, he made it clear that he valued his experience there, he valued his growth there, that there wasn't going to be any sort of like bashing the program on his way out. Trent, you heard a little bit of what he had to say on Wednesday. Were there any big takeaways you had from his press conference that really resonated with you?
Well, if you were looking for any type of soundbite, anything bashing Ohio State that you could put on social media, it definitely wasn't going to come from Tony Elford. Like you said, he sounded like he had nothing but good experiences at Ohio State. I do think it was interesting. He said that it was time for him to move on after 9 years. And he said maybe they felt the same way.
Yeah.
That was a little interesting, especially after all the Ohio State social media accounts come out saying that he was terrible. He was going to get fired anyway. They were going to replace him. So I thought that was a little bit of an interesting tidbit from him. And then go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, yeah, I picked that up too on the comment where, you know, he was talking about how he felt like it was time to move on and maybe they felt the same way too. And he also said something to the effect of, you know, people want to know why I did what I did. And he said, the people that need to know. And so to me, it's like, I do believe that he looked at the opportunity at Michigan and he thought, okay, this is a great opportunity for me. But based on what he said and some of the things you hear coming out of Columbus, it does sound like maybe the two were sort of going their separate ways before that anyway. And that's what led Tony Elford ultimately to Ann Arbor. And there, you know, there's some relationships there. He's familiar with Sherrone Moore. Obviously, he's got a great relationship with Donovan Edwards that he built on the recruiting trail. He talked a little bit about that. And it was nice to sort of hear, you know, you recruit a kid out of high school, you know, a young Donovan Edwards out of high school, and you get to know him and meet him a little bit. And now you come back to Ann Arbor as he gets into his senior year and you get to see what kind of man he is now. So it was really cool to hear Elford talk a little bit about that. But I don't know, man. I find I'll ask you, is it because I'm a fan that I struggle so much? Like, I don't know how you spend 10 years in Columbus and then you come to Michigan and you put on that Block M and you're a part of, you know, you're a Michigan Wolverine now. Like, how do you make that switch so quickly? Like, how is there not still a part of you somewhere in there that's like, screw the Wolverines? You know what I mean? Like, how do you not let that become a part of who you are when you're at a program like that for so long where the rivalry is so intense? How does that happen?
I don't know, man. I was trying to think of the same thing when that news got initially got announced. Like, yeah, it's not like he was there. Okay, it's not like he's from California. His roots are in USC, UCLA. He gets a job at Ohio State for one season, and then he gets a promotion to go to Michigan. You know, there wouldn't be a ton of ties right there. But he spent 9 years, at Ohio State, and then you just come on over to Michigan. And yeah, you're supporting that Block M now in your chest, and you're coaching the kids that have beat you 3 years in a row. And he talked about how Donovan Edwards tells him that all the time.
Reminds him often. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't know. It's to me. So kind of putting in my shoes, if I had to go cover Ohio State, I've been supporting Michigan for 30 years and it would be so difficult to go cover Ohio State.
Okay. Well, here's, I guess, maybe that's the distinction, is covering Ohio State would be one thing. Rooting for them is another thing. But I feel like when you're part of the staff, like you kind of inherently you have to root for your program, right? So,
yeah,
so do I think I could cover Ohio State? Yeah, I think I could cover them. But could I ever get to a point where I'm rooting for that program? Absolutely not. And I think that's where like I struggle to like – I'm glad he's here because, to be honest, he seemed, you know, classy guy, nothing but good things to say about where he was before, but obviously excited about the opportunity here. And he's got some good relationships here, and he talked about sort of, you know, he got a lot of shit from Ohio State fans about who he was as a recruiter, but he talked a bit, you know, I think Angelique from the Detroit News asked him, you know, you're known as a great recruiter, and he said, it depends on who you ask. And I think that was sort of a nod to some of the blowback he's gotten from Columbus, but he talked about his recruiting philosophy and how he has kids. And, you know, he tries to treat everybody the way that he would want his kids to be treated. And I mean, at the end of the day, he seems like a really down to earth guy who's great at building relationships. And so I think he's going to be great for the University of Michigan. I think that it's a really good replacement for Mike Hart and obviously the success that he had while he was here. But I just could not help but keep going back to like, how do you spend a decade in Columbus and then all of a sudden throw out all that shit and put on the Block M and feel good about that? Like that just takes a certain type of person. And maybe he's a better man than I. I think that's pretty.
Well, look at Greg Madison. He was at Michigan for how long? And then he goes over to Ohio State. That was really, really strange when that happened.
Al Washington made the same move. Yeah. At the same time. Yeah, I mean, it certainly happens. It certainly happens. But I think for us, we're used to being on the other side of it, like watching Greg Madison go, watching Al Washington go, watching, you know, Joey Velasquez, who, you know, he had somewhat of a role on the team, wasn't a prominent player, but just like an interest. I think he's originally from Columbus, so maybe that's why that move made sense to him. But I think he's walking on at Ohio State now. But overall, I walked away from that press conference, you know, thinking pretty highly of Tony Elford. And again, I think he's a good fit for Sherrone Moore's staff. And I think he's obviously going to build solid relationships with the players. He just seems like that kind of dude. And when you talk about a guy who's good at building relationships, Lamar Morgan, the defensive backs coach, I mean, that guy is as personable as they come. It was my first time hearing him speak person to person. And he had a lot of good things to say about the secondary. He talked about Will Johnson and just, you know, how Will... One of the things that stood out to me is he said, Will practices like he is a walk-on, like he is a true freshman still trying to earn his way. He referred to Will Johnson as the ultimate teammate. And one of the interesting tidbits that stuck out was somebody had asked him about, you know, how do you replace a guy like Mike Sainristil? Somebody who's, I mean, most people you ask will consider Mike Sainristil to be a Michigan football legend for what he did during his time at Michigan. And Lamar Morgan singled out Zeke Berry. And we've talked about Zeke Berry before. Matter of fact, there was one guy on this panel here smart enough to draft him for the spring draft. And that was yours truly, Zeke Berry.
Can we talk about who the fans think has a better team?
We don't need to talk about that yet. Okay, what is the percentage? We did the spring draft last week. I'm getting my ass kicked according to the fans.
I think I have like 77% of the votes, man. So 77%
of the people out there are siding with Trent's roster for the spring game. But you know, we'll see how it shakes out. After listening to these guys talk, I'm feeling very confident about the roster that I put together. But he spoke very highly of Zeke Berry and said that that was a guy who was sort of standing out as maybe a potential replacement to Mike Sainristil, a guy that you can move around, you can do a lot of different things with. Zeke Berry was actually at the podium today. We got to hear from him a little bit, and you can tell he's sort of, I don't know, you can't really judge a person by who they are when they're in front of the media. You know, I think he did a good job, but I think he's still trying to figure out who he is as a leader. And he even acknowledged that trying to fill the void that Mike Sainristil is leaving behind is not going to be an easy task. But he's also a guy who's paid his dues. He's a guy that's been around for a while. He's going into his junior year. We talked about this on the previous show, Trent, that, you know, it's a kid, I think he was out of California, 4-star recruit, was one of the highest rated safeties coming out of high school. And so he's paid his dues. It feels like his time is now, and Lamar Morgan certainly thinks a lot of him. We also got Samaj Morgan today at the press conference.
That dude's a blast all the time.
I love, he is, yeah. The thing about Samaj Morgan is I put out a little clip and I'm sure the people here saw it. It's impossible not to smile when he's around. Like everything he says, you just kind of, you wait for the answer, but you do so with a smile. And he's just got this energy about him that is infectious. He's one of the most likable players that's ever stepped to the mic. And people were excited to hear him talk today, and he certainly delivered. He gave a lot of insight into who's returning kicks and returning punts. And that might be something I want to talk with you about, because there was, based on what his answer was, there was a little bit of concern among some of the fans on some of the names that he mentioned. So he was asked by Clayton Safey of the Wolverine, he was asked, you know, kick returns and punt returns, who's sort of taking over that role right now? And Samaj, you know, as he does, you know, he started with Will Johnson. He mentioned Zeke Berry. Frederick Moore is another guy, wide receiver, sophomore wide receiver, who's being talked about a lot this spring. I would buy stock in Frederick Moore immediately. It sounds like he's going to play a pretty big role on the offense this fall. But he talked about these guys. And he said, don't kick it to us. Don't kick it to us. Whatever you do, whoever we have back there, whether it's punt return, kick return, don't kick it to us. It's dangerous. The only thing that can stop us is the sun, is essentially what he said. But there were a lot of people that were concerned that he mentioned Will Johnson as one of the guys returning punts and returning kicks. Trent, your thoughts on having a All-American cornerback returning kicks and returning punts?
Man, I'm right there with everyone else that has some concern about it. You're talking about the number one corner in all of college football. If he takes one tackle on punt return and goes down, I mean, that's going to potentially kill your season. Like if you have somebody as a Samaj Morgan or a Frederick Moore that has the ability to return punts, throw them back there, let them run it back. Don't put your arguably your best player on the roster back there to get hurt.
You know what, Trent? I love your answer. But I love it because I completely disagree with it. One of the things that I think can suck on these shows is if we're constantly in lockstep and we agree on everything, like there's no interesting discussion to be had. When it comes to this topic, I completely disagree. And I want to preface that by saying I do understand the concern by having a guy like Will Johnson back there, because of course, if he gets injured, I mean, it's, you know, we felt the pain when you lose a guy like Rod Moore and you're not sure when he's going to come back. Like that's a huge loss in the secondary. You certainly don't want to risk losing Will Johnson. But the reality is, like, you could lose Will Johnson in the spring game. You could lose him in a practice. You could lose him in a fall practice. You could lose him, you know, as he's playing defense, you know, as, you know, trying to lock somebody up. Like there's all sorts of situations that can contribute to an injury. My thought is, if he's a guy who's a game changer, returning kicks and returning punts, if you could take one to the house, that can, I mean, you know, there's going to be some teams on Michigan's schedule that they should beat anyway. But in a big time game, if you can rely on a Will Johnson to do some damage in special teams, that can flip a game in your favor. And, you know, what about Desmond Howard? What about guys like Charles Woodson? Like some of their most iconic plays came on special teams and kick returns and punt returns. And so to me, it's like, if this guy's elite at doing it, let the guy do it. Like at the end of the day, this is sports. This is about playing football, and we can't treat these guys like they're made of glass. Like these are top level athletes. Injuries happen, but they can happen anytime, anywhere. I feel like Michigan will have other options than Will Johnson. So we'll probably see other guys. Like I even saying what I just said, I'll still be surprised if Will Johnson's returning punts and returning kicks. I could see it being Frederick Morris, Samaj Morgan, certainly. But at the end of the day, if you are in Columbus, and you know the game's tied in the fourth quarter, and you got 5 minutes left, and Ohio State's got a punt, and you know Will Johnson is that dude, I'm putting Will Johnson back there. Like, I'm not going to worry about it at that point. So
a situation like that, I agree with you.
Right.
But if you're more
situational.
Yeah. So if you're playing against Arkansas State and you put Will Johnson back there, you don't need Will Johnson back there against Arkansas State.
Yeah.
Say he goes down, gets an injury. He's out for the year. Was that worth putting Will Johnson on the punt return team for a potential injury?
I agree. I didn't hear Samaj mention Alex Orji once as being a potential kick returner this year, which is disappointing considering he was on pace to be the greatest kick returner in the history of college football. But yeah, I do agree with you, Trent. You don't want to see him against Fresno State or a team that Michigan should be able to handle. I do think it's situational, but I also think like you got to use your weapons. You got to use your horses. And if these guys are fully capable and elite and dangerous in what they do, if Will Johnson is that guy returning punts, like I say, put him back there. Like I don't subscribe to the idea that you should protect guys in every single way possible to avoid injury when you could be potentially shooting yourself short in areas that could flip a game in your favor. So if it is against an Ohio State, if it's against an Oregon, maybe it's against Texas week two, you know what I mean? You need a big play in the secondary. You look to Will Johnson like that. I'm not going to have an issue with Sharon Moore making that call. And a lot of people point to Ronnie Bell and they're like, well, look at what happened to Ronnie Bell. But I don't know. Look at what happened to Rod Moore. Look at what happened to Jake Butt. You know, look at what happened to a lot of these guys in different scenarios. Like, injuries happen. I don't think that you can coach and make decisions based on a potential injury that you think could occur.
And I would 100% subscribe to this. Say Will Johnson was an A grade as a punt returner, and then your second guy in line was a C. Like, I get that, but I don't think that's the case. I feel like you could put a Samaj Morgan back there and potentially do just as well as Will Johnson's going to do. Or even Frederick Moore, whoever, it doesn't matter. I feel like the punt return game, granted, yeah, Will Johnson could potentially take one to the house, but I think that these players are going to be so close to each other that I don't think you need to do it.
Yeah, I agree. Unless there's a need, I don't think we're going to see it, but I didn't have the same feeling that a lot of people had where it's like, why would you put Will Johnson back there? I'm like, well, if he's incredible, if he's a home run threat every time he touches the ball, like why wouldn't you, was my thought. Like, I get the injury sort of deal, but again, that can happen on any single play. Meredith Richard from the Facebook page, she asks, any update on the QB battle? No, but what I will say is this is something that has now become a theme throughout spring media availability. I've heard it every single time I've been there. And it continued today with Samaj Morgan when somebody, you know, he's a wide receiver. He had JJ McCarthy last year. Obviously, you're trying to work with new quarterbacks this year. Every single time the quarterbacks are brought up, Alex Orji is the first name mentioned. I might be reading too much into it. It might not mean anything, but I don't know. I feel like that. I'll ask you, Trent, do you think I'm reading too much into it? Or do you think the fact that Alex Orji is always mentioned first tells you a little bit about where this battle stands, at least in the spring?
I mean, at the very minimum, I think it means that he's the best quarterback on the roster currently, right? I'm not saying that Alex Orji might be the answer to Michigan's quarterback problems. I mean, maybe Michigan will look at the transfer portal in the spring. I don't know. But I do think that you're correct in saying that everyone always mentions Alex Orji right away. So to me, that tells me that he's number one on the depth chart currently.
Yeah. I agree. I mean, it's just like, when somebody asks you to name, you know, your favorite restaurants, if you keep saying the same one over and over, it's like, well, okay, that must be your favorite. I mean, it's constant every single time. Alex Orji is the first name that somebody talks about when they mention the quarterbacks. I'm going to ask you about this, Trent, because we haven't really done an episode where we take a lot of fan questions or even comments, but I find this one to be interesting because I feel a little bit differently than Ryan Markham from the Facebook page. I'll read his comment. He says, I'm really concerned about Michigan's offensive line and the wide receivers. I don't necessarily feel that way. Trent, what is your feeling right now as it stands in April about Michigan's offensive line and the wide receivers?
I have zero concern about the offensive line. Michigan's going to have almost everybody that they might start is going to have some sort of game experience.
Yeah.
Last year, almost every game was a blowout 3 quarters into the season. And they did a great job of getting guys into the game action. Gio Elhadi played a ton of games 2 years ago, played some last year. Greg Crippen, he's seen plenty of time. We know what Michigan has in Miles Hinton. I mean, these guys, Josh Preby, he was an all Big Ten guard. I mean, I'm not worried at all with the offensive line. With that being said, I think depth could potentially be an issue, which hopefully injuries don't happen, but I mean, it's part of the game. Receiver, I have a little bit of concern with receiver. I don't think Michigan's very deep at all at receiver. I mean, I do think Samaj Morgan and Tyler Morris could be a good 1-2 punch, but I do think Michigan will look into the transfer portal to at least get a big bodied receiver. There's nobody with much size on this roster other than Peyton O'Leary. And there's a reason why he hasn't seen a ton of live game action. I feel like, so I wouldn't be shocked if they go get a 6'3", 6'4" bodied receiver that they can play on the outside.
Yeah, it wouldn't hurt. I mean, I'm not going to sit here and say no, Michigan wouldn't be able to utilize something like that, because I think they would. Ryan, and I agree with you, Trent, with the first part of Ryan's comment, like with the offensive line, like I don't have any concern there. Maybe a little bit at depth, you know, who's going to fill in. But even then, Michigan's got some pretty good depth on the offensive line. You talk about it. It starts with Greg Crippen at the center position, Giovanni Alhadi at guard, Preby at the other guard. You got Miles Hinton, and then you got Jeffrey Percy and Andrew Gentry battling it out for the other tackle position. So I feel like that starting unit is damn near solidified already this spring. Then it's a matter of what the depth is going to look like. I mean, a guy like Tristan Bounds, who's been with the program for a while, where is he going to fit in? There's a lot of guys that I think could help with the depth, but that's my concern. Not necessarily the starting unit, but where is some of that depth going to come from? In terms of wide receivers, I like what I'm hearing so far. I like Samaj Morgan. I like Tyler Morris. I like Frederick Moore, who, again, is somebody who has been mentioned a lot. There was a comparison. I can't remember who they compared him to today, but a guy in the NFL who I think is doing pretty well. I'll have to go back and pull the video, but people are talking pretty highly about Frederick Moore. And the more we do these pressers, the more I'm getting excited about watching him play in the spring and then seeing what that translates into the fall. And then, you know, another name I heard today from Samaj Morgan. He also happens to be on my spring roster, Trent. Kendrick Bell, KB, Ronnie Bell's little brother. You know, Samaj said, hey, this is a guy that makes plays too. And I think that, you know, he's going to have to develop. He's got a slim frame. I think he's got to put on some weight, but he's got a little more height than those other guys. If you caught it, one of the videos that Michigan put out recently, they're putting out little hype videos from their spring practices. There was a catch that Kendrick Bell made that was incredibly impressive. Now, I don't know in what capacity, like, was he out of position? Was the ball off the mark? I don't know any of those things. All I know is he went up and snagged the ball out of the air, and it looked pretty damn good. And that's why I put him on my spring roster, because he's somebody that I'm intrigued to see this spring go out and play. I think he's a guy who could potentially become that Cornelius Johnson type guy, somebody who can high point the ball. I think he might be 6'3", a little bit, 6'2".
He's 6'3". Just very raw.
Yeah, very raw, and he's got to put on a little bit of weight to be able to, you know, to go through the gauntlet of the type of Big Ten season that Michigan is going to face. So, yeah, Ryan, I mean, I'm not going to say it's not valid to have concerns there, but I don't feel that necessarily maybe as strongly as some others might.
I mean, I really wouldn't be concerned about the starting offensive line whatsoever. I think Michigan will have a top 10 at the minimum offensive line in the country. But yes, the depth, I think, could be concerning if injuries would arise.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Trent, I'll let you take this one as well from Jacob Morris. Do we see more of Benjamin Hall or Khalil Mullings? I feel like it's a given, but what do you think here, Trent?
I think it's a given as well. I mean, it's got to be Khalil Mullings. But I will say, I'm on that Benjamin Hall hype train. Last year at the spring game, the way he ran, very powerful, has explosiveness to him. I think that as long as he sticks around, I think that he could be a big-time player for Michigan potentially next season.
Yeah, and again, your boy picked him for the spring draft. So these names that keep popping up, they just have.
I feel like you're only bringing it up because they were on your team.
This is a fan question here. I didn't have any control over this, but they just happen to be on my roster. So I think it's a valid question, Jacob. But I think Khalil Mullings is going to. I think it's a 1-2 punch between Donovan Edwards and Khalil Mullings, unless there's some sort of nagging injury. But I do think the guy in that third spot is Benjamin Hall. There's no doubt about it. And Tony Alford talked about him a little bit. We've heard him brought up multiple times. I've seen videos of his offseason workout. He is built like a tank. He's quick. He's physical. He is powerful. He is tough to bring down. He's a guy that I think Michigan can rely on as an every down back. I think it's only a matter of time, to be quite honest, until Benjamin Hall solidifies himself as the feature back at the University of Michigan. But in terms of what things look like this season, this coming 2024 season, I think he's the third guy off the sideline. But I certainly think we're going to see him getting some meaningful reps in some big games. I think he just brings that extra element.
Thinking ahead a little bit, I feel like Benjamin Hall and Jordan Marshall with some cool Cabana in there could be a really, really good running back room for Michigan.
Yeah, I like that too. Cole Cabana, we might not see him this spring either. We didn't see him last spring, as far as I can remember. Apparently, he's still working through something, last I heard. So, you know, we'll see if he's going to be available for the spring. But, I mean, everything we heard, quickness, you know, the agility, all the stuff you want to see in that position. Really excited to see a healthy Cole Cabana. Just wondering when that's going to happen at this point. Let's see if we can take another question before we move on. Blake Corum said that Benjamin Hall is an animal. I totally agree.
Someone said something about Wink Martindale up there.
There was Jerry Judy. Yes, Jennifer from the YouTube page, actually, Jennifer Davis Smith. Thank you. I think it was Jerry Judy was the comparison that Samaj Morgan made to Frederick Moore.
I'll take an Alabama Jerry Judy on Michigan.
That's what I'm saying. You know what I mean? Like, they were talking about the way that he can, you know, the way he adjusts to the ball and some of the, you know, some of the plays he's able to make. And so I'm telling you, the Frederick Moore hype is real. Every single guy that comes to the podium is talking about Frederick Moore in some capacity. We hear what Frederick Moore is doing as a wide receiver. We hear what he's doing in special teams. This is a guy to keep your eye on. You know, somewhat of an unknown because he didn't get a lot of run during his true freshman year. But as he transitions into that sophomore year, it sounds like he's going to be a big part of what Michigan tries to do offensively. Penny Neer, anybody redshirting that I know of? Not necessarily. We heard rumors that Jaden Davis, true freshman quarterback, may redshirt. And I think that's probably the most likely scenario. But, you know, we also heard that he is just as much in the running for the starting job as anybody else at this point. I think that's a little bit of coach speak. I would probably lean more towards Jaden Davis redshirting his freshman year. What are your thoughts on that, Trent?
Yeah, I agree with you. While
any chance he earns that QB1 spot as a freshman?
While I want to think that he's the next JJ McCarthy on Michigan's roster, I don't know that it's going to necessarily be true this season. So yeah, I mean, I think as long as Alex Orji, Jaden Denegal, whoever can solidify that starting quarterback role, I mean, I don't see why you wouldn't redshirt Jaden Davis.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And Trent, you selected this guy. I believe you got him with your 9th overall pick. I thought it was a heck of a pick.
Might be
the steal of the spring game draft. Chad Zolman from the Facebook page says, do we see Peyton O'Leary seeing any time on the field this year? What do you think, Trent?
Well, if you look at their depth chart right now, their roster, he's got to play because they only have 5 or 6 scholarship receivers on that roster. So, I mean, the way they rotate, he's going to play unless they go out there and go to the transfer portal and bring guys in. But yeah, I do think he's going to carve out some sort of a role this season for Michigan.
Yeah, I feel like he's not a guy who's going to go out and make explosive plays. I don't feel like he's a playmaker. And I don't say that as somebody, I'm not trying to sound offensive when I say that, but I think he's a guy who can go out and be solid. I think he's a guy who can go out and have sure hands. If it's a third down, third and short, and you need somebody that can, you know, if he can run a quick out route or whatever. Like, I think there is a place for Peyton O'Leary to see the field this year. I just don't think he's going to be the big play guy. Would love for nothing more than to be proven wrong, because he's been in the program for a while. We saw flashes of it last year during the spring game, and it would be great.
Back-to-back spring games, he's been really good.
I think is number 81. If he sticks with it, it would be great to see Peyton O'Leary go out and have himself a year. But Chad, I think to answer the question, yes, he is going to see some time. I think it's just a matter of, you know, in what role and what capacity, but you'll see number 81 on the field this year. There's no doubt about it. Let's keep going with some of these questions. I like this. I like this. P. Maximus from the YouTube page said, Samaj also said, Will Johnson, Tyler Morris, Zeke Barry, and him are practicing kickoffs and punts. We kind of addressed that a little bit earlier, the Will Johnson stuff. I mean, same feeling about the other guys, Tyler Morris and Zeke Barry back there as well. I mean, hell, Samaj Morgan, when you talk about how thin the wide receiver room is, do you want to risk potentially losing a Samaj Morgan as a wide receiver? I mean, do you? It's not at the level that you feel Will Johnson. Like, if you lose Will Johnson at one of the corner positions, that is going to hurt. But do you also have those same concerns with a guy like Tyler Morris, who I think is going to be wide receiver number one on the roster, Samaj Morgan, who's damn near close to being that? Do you have those same concerns with those guys?
Yeah, I do. But they're just, at least right now, they are not the caliber of player that Will Johnson is. If you take Will Johnson off of that defense, it's a blow. And yeah, I mean, it would definitely hurt if Samaj Morgan goes down or Tyler Morris goes down. But I just don't think it would be the impact that Will Johnson would be going down. That's just where I'm at.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think Michigan's at a point, and Trent, you made this point, I think, either on the last show or the prior show, that as far as Michigan's starters go, outside of the quarterback position, as far as, and there's a cornerback position that Michigan also has to address as well, but outside of those two things, as far as the starters go, Michigan is extremely solid going into this season, and when you look at just the starting unit, this is a team that 100% should be one of the favorites to win the conference, be right back in the playoff and in the hunt to win a national championship. But it's at depth that you get a little bit concerned who are going to be some of those other guys that are able to step up, because that was one of Michigan's perhaps biggest, strongest points last season. Was it was just a, you know, plug replace sort of deal. Like they could sub in, sub out, like they could rotate 5-6 guys and they wouldn't lose a step. I don't really know that Michigan is going to be able to do that this season. I'm not really sure where that depth is going to come from, but you know, we've talked about guys defensively like Eno Etta, you know, the, you know, 6'5", 295-pound edge rusher. You know, he's going to factor in, but Michigan also has studs at the edge right now. They've got studs on the defensive line, they've got studs at linebacker, and they've got some guys in the secondary that I think can pose some problems. So that's going to be interesting. Long story short, P. Maximus from the YouTube page, I feel good about all the guys you mentioned returning kicks and returning punts, but there is a little bit of concern because you don't know where the depth is, that if somebody does have a nagging injury, particularly a Will Johnson, the type of impact that's going to have on Michigan season.
So real quick, talking about the receivers, I'm on Michigan's spring roster. They have four receivers who return that has any sort of game action whatsoever. And Michigan has six scholarship receivers. One of those guys is Christian Dixon, who has been rumored that he's playing defensive back now.
Defense, yeah.
So, I mean, you're looking at possibly five guys on their current spring roster that even has a scholarship. Four guys that has game experience.
Whatever happened to Marion Walker? Where did he go? Where did he end up?
He went to Ole Miss.
He did go to Ole Miss.
I mean, and then Darius Clemens went to Oregon State.
Yeah, it'd be nice to have those guys in the rotation at this point, but you know, that's the era that we're in right now. We'll take one more here. Let's see, from Matt Kirby. Have you seen Alex Orji throwing? The answer is no.
If you listen to the players and coaches, he can sling it around.
Yeah, and well, here's the thing. I say no jokingly, but again, I shoot from the sidelines every game, and I watch him throw during the warmups, and I understand that, you know, warmups are quite a bit different from gameplay. But yeah, he's got an arm; he can sling it. And if you talk to the guys, like, forget who it was, it might have been Josiah Stewart, who was like, you know, for anybody out there that thinks he can't throw the ball. Like, dude can throw the ball. Like, that's not an issue. Now, doesn't mean that Alex Orji doesn't have things to work on, right? I do think he is a work in progress. But Kurt Campbell said this, and there's some people even within the Michigan media that don't necessarily believe it. But Kurt Campbell said he believes that the guy who can lead Michigan to where they need to be is already on the roster. So that question of, you know, is Michigan interested in going out and getting a quarterback out of the portal this spring? Certainly didn't sound like it, according to Kurt Campbell. And then if you listen to the players and the coaches based on what they're seeing from the quarterbacks, they think they've got a lot of good options. And yeah, Jacob Morris, I mean, he's thick. We'll put him that way. Like, I put out that picture of it was him, Colson Loveland, and Donovan Edwards standing together. And Alex Orji, like, if you look at his thighs, like, he's got the thighs of a defensive lineman. Like, it's no wonder why Michigan brought him in and used him as a wrecking ball last season, because I can't imagine it's easy to bring a guy like that down. But Trent, you and I have talked about this. If he is Michigan's QB1 this fall, do you want him to play that same type of role where he's coming in, pulling the ball, and he's taking all these hits? Not really. Nope. You know, that's nope. Not really a role you want to see him. I'm fine. Like, we saw JJ McCarthy do it, right? We didn't want JJ McCarthy to take a bunch of hits, but JJ would get out of the pocket. He would try to make things happen with his arm. And if it broke down and couldn't make it happen with his arm, he would take off and run. And sometimes he would put his shoulder down. Sometimes he would take a big hit, but he was a tough kid. And that was just kind of in his DNA. So I don't want to take that element completely away from Alex Orji, because I think it's so valuable, but you know, you certainly would not want to see him take as many hits and to be maybe as physical this year if he is QB1.
Yeah, man, if you put him at linebacker, like, I know that he's not a linebacker, but you put him back there, he looks the part like right now. You wouldn't even need him to go through the weight room or anything like that, because he literally is built and looks like a legit linebacker.
There's no doubt. There's no doubt about it. All right, let's move on. We're at 46 minutes here. Trent has an early flight. Trent has to take a flight at what, 2:30 in the morning?
No, we're leaving at 2:30. The flight's at 6:05, 6:10, I don't know, whatever it is.
So he's leaving, for some odd reason, he's leaving his house at 2:30. His flight's at 6. He's flying out to Vegas. He's going to be out, you know how it is when the boy gets out in Vegas, he's going to have himself a good time. He's probably going to get a little bit crazy taking a Wayne Newton. Is Wayne Newton still with us? I don't want to disparage Wayne Newton. We'll stay away from the Wayne Newton stuff. You're going out to Vegas. You got a bowling tournament that's out there that you're going to be competing in. So we can't keep Trent too long. He needs his beauty rest. He's got to be on his game for Vegas.
I'm sure all the bowlers in here totally understand, you know, just
they get it.
Yeah, you know, all the bowlers are watching right now. They get what's going on.
Let's see your wife.
Look, there's one.
There is. Listen, there is somebody in here who understands your pain. And from what I understand, your wife is a pretty damn good bowler too. So you guys are. Do you compete with each other? Like, is there a sort of a sense of, like, you know, it's your wife and you love her and you want her. You want her to compete.
You know.
All right, Trent, you're digging that one. Let's move on from the bowling talk here. I could spend hours talking about bowling, Trent, but we just don't have.
I'm sure you could, man. I'm sure.
We just don't have the time to do it. I put out an article earlier this week, and I was talking a little bit about, you know, some of the big changes that are coming to the Big Ten Conference this year, and I think that overall, it's you know, we've talked about on the show multiple times, at least I know I've said it, that there's a part of me that hates the way that college football is changing and college athletics are changing, and, you know, NIL and transfer portal, and, you know, there, you know, people have talked about, you have your roster now in the spring, but you have no idea if those are going to be the guys you can rely on in the fall. And I think it's just, it's a weird place for everybody to be right now that's trying to adjust to it. But when the season kicks off this year, it is going to be arguably one of the most memorable seasons in Big Ten football history because of a few things. Number one, most obvious, is you have the addition of Oregon, Washington, UCLA, and USC. And in the article I put out on wingedhelmetmedia.com, those are big name brands, but I think that the only team coming in that Michigan faces this year that's going to pose a real serious problem to me is Oregon. I mean, you've got USC trying, you know, how do you replace Caleb Williams? That's a Heisman Trophy winning quarterback. You got Washington that's lost a ton of talent. How do you replace Michael Penix Jr.? You got UCLA, who I don't think is going to be very good at all. I've kind of done a little bit of reading up on UCLA. They haven't recruited well, and then they just lost their head coach, who chose to go and take a coordinator position with Ohio State and Chip Kelly. So just on that part of it alone, when you think about that and you think about these four teams joining the Big Ten, have you gotten to a point, Trent, where you're excited about that? Or is it still something that, you know, maybe you still feel these are Pac-12 teams. Like, this feels a little bit weird. This doesn't feel right. Where do you stand on the incorporation of Oregon, Washington, UCLA, and USC into the Big Ten?
When it first got announced, I hated it. I'm like, these guys are Pac-12 schools. Even though I'm only 30, I'm kind of I like the tradition, and I don't know. I just didn't like it. I felt like we were getting closer to one mega conference when that got announced. And then you had Texas going to the SEC, but now that it's almost here, I'm excited about it. I'm excited to see USC at the Big House. I'm excited to see Oregon at the Big House during a regular season competition. So yeah, I mean, I'm pretty excited about it now, and I'm so happy they got rid of the divisions. It was so needed. The East just absolutely killed the West every single time they played.
Let's talk about that, because that was my second point. And I think that's going to be huge for the way that this season plays out, is that, you know, for the first time in, I don't know, how long has it been? The East and West, that started in 2014. So that's been at least 10 years, but the East and West is no longer. Michigan doesn't have any division, the Big Ten doesn't have any divisions at this point. So it will be the two best teams in the conference playing for the conference championship. Initial thoughts. I heard you said that you're excited about that. Continue on.
Yeah, I mean, that's basically it. I just felt like the way they made these divisions, it just wasn't, I don't know if fair's the right word, but you stack Michigan, Ohio State, and Penn State into one division, and you basically had Wisconsin and Iowa over there. And it just was not competitive. And you saw that every single time that the two teams would meet in the Big Ten championship. It just wasn't all that competitive, and the East just dominated.
Yeah, and to your point, what I put in the article, and I'll just read it out. During the 10 years of the East and West divisions, the East was a perfect 10-0 in the conference championship game. The East beat the West in those 10 contests by an average of 20.7 points per game. And the last three championship games, which were all won by the University of Michigan, by the way, were decided by an average of 28.7 points. So the East was 10-0, beating the West on average in the championship game by 20-plus points. And over the last 3 years, it's been damn near 30 points per game. So there's absolutely no doubt that there was some change that needed to be made there. There were some people that, and I saw this brought up, that they thought that the divisions should stay, but that all of the newcomers from the Pac-12 should go into the Big Ten West, and then you should sort things out that way. Would you have been more favorable towards that versus getting rid of divisions overall? Because I think, and somebody brought it up here, Matt, it's Matt Kirby, and this is part of what we're going to get to. We're talking about maybe the potential of, you know, do you need to move that Ohio State game now that there's no divisions? Because if you look at the last 3 years, if I'm not mistaken, regardless of who the winner was for Michigan and Ohio State, if there were no divisions 2021, 22, and 23, it would have been Michigan, Ohio State the next week in Indy, if I'm not mistaken. Is that correct?
Without looking at it, yes, I mean, believe
Purdue had 7 wins, I believe, in the West. Before that, it was Iowa. They weren't a very strong team. And then Iowa this past season came into the Big Ten championship game with 10 wins. So it would have been Michigan, Ohio State every single year. And I talked about this a little bit, and I put this idea out because I saw some people floating it, and this is one of the things I wanted to talk about. Matt Kirby mentioned it. The possibility of moving the game, Michigan and Ohio State, from that final week of the regular season. And Trent, you and I haven't really talked about this too much. I mean, I've made my thoughts known on social media, but I'm curious, where do you stand on the potential of moving that game away from, you know, Thanksgiving weekend to somewhere else in the season? Do you even think it's something that should be considered at this point?
Right now, I don't think it's going to. Does it need to be considered? Maybe. Do I think that it will be considered? No. Not until it becomes a problem. You're used to Michigan, Ohio State playing that last game. And I just don't think all the traditionalists out there, I don't think that they're going to move it. Now, I mean, if it does happen when Michigan, Ohio State play that last game, and then they meet up the very next week for the Big Ten championship, potentially meet up right around the corner for a playoff game, then I think that the talking heads might start talking about it a little bit more and maybe move that. And then I think you believe that it should be moved to the season opener if it would.
Oh, you know what? I have been on a streak of putting out takes that just get people riled up, whether it's our top 10 lists or moving the game from the final week to the opening week. Like, haven't necessarily had the most popular. There were some people that sided with me on that, but by and large, there were people that were like, no, you can't move it to the season opener. Neither team is at their best. It's going to be a sloppy game. You know, here it is again, Matt Kirby, who brought up the question, not the first game. I do think, I'm not saying that it should be moved yet, but I do think that it's something that fans maybe should start to consider, and that I do think it's something we're going to see happen eventually, unless the Big Ten brings back divisions and there's some way to avoid a potential rematch from Michigan, Ohio State final week of the year to Michigan, Ohio State in the Big Ten championship game. Because we've seen before that the game itself, the way college football was, that game determined so much. That game at the end of the year determined who was going to play for a Big Ten championship. And in the playoff era, for the most part, it determined who was going to have an opportunity to go play for a national championship. Now, without the divisions, and now with an expanded playoff where you're having 12 teams in the playoff, you're talking about a very realistic scenario where Michigan and Ohio State play three times in a season. And if that occurs, you know, if you're Michigan and Ohio State and you play the final regular season and then you meet in the Big Ten championship and you split that and you meet again in the playoff, to me, that final regular season game, there's just so much less value than there was before. And you're playing not consecutively, but you're meeting each other in a short amount of time. And so I think it takes a lot of juice. I mean, shit. It's realistic. There's a scenario where Michigan and Ohio State go into that final game of the regular season, and both teams already know at that point they're both going to be in Indy playing each other the next week, regardless of what the outcome is.
That's very possible.
So to me, how much value is there in having that game in the final week of the regular season at that point, particularly if that's the scenario? And I think that's one of the things that, for as much as I'm excited about what's happening with college football and what's happening within the Big Ten, it does feel like we are on the fast track to that Thanksgiving tradition, that game between Michigan and Ohio State, the final weekend of the regular season, having so much meaning, carrying so much weight, because the reality is there's a realistic scenario where it doesn't matter if you win or lose that game, you're playing again next week. And then you're probably going to play each other, or you have a good chance of facing each other in the playoff. And so I started to think, okay, if that's the case and you want to try to avoid that and you want to bring meaning back to the game in this new era of college football, how do you do that? I don't like the idea of tucking it in the middle of the season. I saw somebody say, you know, put it near Halloween or something like that, where both teams have had enough time to play. Still going to be playoff implications, but you'll also have a few games afterwards to try to recover. I don't like that idea. As I'm sitting here in April, I'm thinking to myself, if I knew that we were, I don't know, 5 months away from Michigan, Ohio State to open the season in Columbus under the lights, I would be jacked up about that game. And I think anybody out there would be lying if they said they wouldn't be excited about it. And this idea that, you know, both teams are going to be, you know, not very good or not playing at their best. Like, it's not like we don't see big time matchups to open the season in college football. Like, that happens. Like, when did Ohio State play Notre Dame last season? That was early in the year. Was it week?
Yeah, it was second or third week.
Second or third week. Michigan plays Texas in a big game in the second week of the year. So, yeah, they get the, you know, the home opener to sort of get their sea legs. But I don't necessarily mind the idea of, if there's a scenario where Michigan and Ohio State are going to play in back-to-back weeks at the end of the season and then potentially again in the playoff, I don't mind the idea of moving the game, but I feel like that game needs to carry juice. It needs to carry weight. And the most weight that game would carry is if you knew today that's how you open the season. Michigan, Ohio State. It's either in Columbus, in Ann Arbor, under the lights, primetime. That's how you kick off the college football season. I feel like that's how you could preserve that regular season game meaning so much. And then you talk about setting the tone for the rest of your season. Like, yeah, it could be a sloppy game, but if you go out and beat Ohio State in week one, you're feeling pretty damn good the rest of the year as you go through the remainder of your schedule and try to win a Big Ten championship. So I don't know if that's a really good sales pitch for why the first week makes sense. But that's my line of thinking, because I feel like if you put it anywhere else, you take away some of that juice that, I mean, you spend the whole season leading up to this game at the end of the year, and there used to be so much weight that came along with it. So much
consequence,
you win or you lose.
You don't think there'd be juice to the game if both teams are 7-0 entering the game, Michigan's ranked one, Ohio State's ranked two, whatever it might be, but they're both 7-0. They're playing in the eighth week. I would think there'd be a ton of juice for that.
Well, there's always going to be juice when Michigan and Ohio State plays. There's no doubt about it. Whether, you know, 7-0, you know, whether it's week 7, week 8, whenever it is, there's always going to be juice and excitement. But I feel like as I'm sitting here now and I'm looking at the schedule and I see Michigan, Ohio State week 7, or I see Michigan, Ohio State week 1, Michigan, Ohio State week 1 just does something to me. It gets me a little more excited. It gets me a little more hyped up. And it gives people an entire offseason to think about that week 1 matchup and how incredible that's going to be. So that's my line of thinking. I'm not saying that it's going to be a terrible experience, or that, you know, it won't be enjoyable. Anytime those two teams play, it will be. But like I said, if I'm looking at week 7 right now or week 1, internally I'm more excited about week 1. That's where I'm at. So that's why I would push it there. See, and I'm fine with it being a sloppy game. I'm fine with it, teams trying to figure it out. But you're also talking about two teams that are expected to compete for a national championship. So, you know, the idea that they're going to be terrible, I don't think is accurate. Are they going to be at their best? No, maybe not, but I don't think you're going to see a terrible display of football.
I'm kind of at the mindset where I want both teams to be at their best when they play each other. The best team's going to win the game. That fan base has all the bragging rights. For example, like this year, say the game was week 1. Michigan does not know who their quarterback's going to be. I mean, you know, we all think it's probably going to be Alex Orji, but we have no idea. Ohio State, they might not either, but I think that they probably have a better situation at quarterback than what Michigan does today. So, I mean, if you go out there and say Michigan wanted to play a couple quarterbacks to see which guy was better, that's probably not the game that they're going to do that, especially against your biggest rival, one of the best teams in the nation. I feel like if you want to move the game, I like that three-quarter mark, that week 8 maybe, week 8, 9, you put it there if you want to move it, just so both teams have plenty of time to be as good as they can possibly be for the game. And then if you want, that last week has always been kind of a rivalry week. I know this might not be this is kind of a change of topic, but hell, throw Michigan State in there, or throw Penn State in there. Play them every single year at that last game. Put Ohio State in that 7, 8, 9 mark. Both teams should be ready to go to play each other. Both rosters, they should know who their guys are by that time. It's just, I don't know. I feel like that week 1, there could just be so much up in the air that might take the game feeling out of it.
Yeah, and there's somebody that floated that, I can't remember who it was on the social media page, but talked about, you know, moving the Ohio State game around, you know, to Halloween weekend, and then moving the Michigan State game to the end of the year, because there's a lot of in-state rivalries that take place then. Like, I'm not opposed to any of that. I just don't like the idea that you could win that regular season game, which used to carry so much weight, face each other, and regardless of who's on the winning or losing side, face each other the very next week, lose the Big Ten championship game, and then what was the value in the regular season win? And then, oh, by the way, there's a chance we might meet up in the playoffs anyway. So to me, the value of that game at the end of the season becomes diminished significantly. And I'm trying to think through a way that maybe there's a way to avoid that. And the way that I feel internally to avoid that is to make it a season opener, because, dude, you know how it is when it's week zero or week one of college football and it's kicking. Yeah. Like, everybody is jacked. Everybody's already excited. I mean, we're excited to watch Michigan beat the shit out of ECU. Like, it's just college football is back. If you were to take the greatest rivalry, not just in college sports, but in all of sports, and put that in week one and have an entire offseason of hype and build up to that moment with all the excitement that already comes with opening week of college football, I just think it would be incredible, and it would be the best way to avoid making that final game of the year not feel as important moving forward.
And it doesn't matter where you put this game at. People, it could be week one, it could be week two, it could be week 12. People are going to watch it. People are going to tune in. People are going to be pumped about it. It's Michigan. It's Ohio State. It's the game. It doesn't matter. But it's definitely a very interesting talking point, because I made this comment a few shows ago. Say Michigan, Ohio State play three times in a season. We'll say, let's just say Michigan wins in week 12. They win the Big Ten championship, but then lose in the playoff. Well, then I feel like Ohio State has all the bragging rights, because right. they just beat Michigan when it mattered.
Yeah. And we almost saw that in 2022 when Michigan lost to TCU and Ohio State was a field goal away, right, from going to the national championship. And I believe fully that Ohio State would have beaten TCU in a national championship. So you would have had a situation where Michigan beats Ohio State at the end of the season, Michigan wins a Big Ten championship, but then Ohio State wins a national championship. How good does that regular season win and that Big Ten championship feel compared to a national championship for your rival? It almost feels irrelevant.
You just beat them. So yeah, you have that bragging rights, but Ohio State just won the whole dang thing. So of course who has the bigger bragging rights in that situation?
Yeah. And I think, look, that's why I brought it up. And that's why I thought it was a good talking point, because there is so much change and there are so many scenarios now, but no matter which way it goes, we are now in a territory where that game at the end of the season that we all grew up on, that feeling around Thanksgiving, that feeling of like, this game is going to carry consequence, there is significance to this game, that is going away to a certain extent, almost to the point where, outside of bragging rights, that final game of the regular season, as much as I hate to say it, could be irrelevant. If you still go on to win the Big Ten and ultimately win a national championship, you're not going to be beating yourself up that you lost the regular season final against Ohio State. It just won't matter. And so I feel a little bit sad about that, man. I like the changes, but there's something about that brings me down a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess I could be persuaded to move it to opening day, but
look at that. See, this is all I wanted. I just wanted a little bit of progress.
I'm not there yet.
Well, I'll keep hammering away at it. Eventually we'll get there, and then hopefully we'll get it in the season opener. That would be phenomenal if things stay the way that they are. So we're at an hour and 7 minutes here. I spent a lot of time putting this little video together. I think we can run through it in about 10 minutes. It'll be a fun way to end the show. Right. I spent some time this week just kind of thinking about, I was looking at some of the shots I took from the Rose Bowl, and I was like, damn, that was a beautiful uniform. And then was thinking about some of the uniform combinations that Michigan's had during the Harbaugh era. And then I started to go back, and look at over the last two decades. And I thought to myself, you know what? Let's do a worst to first when it comes to Michigan alternates, because traditionally Michigan has been maize pants, blue top, maize pants, white top. Like, that has been Michigan football, but particularly over the last two decades, they've experimented with that. And I think, quite honestly, I think some of the alternates have become a favorite over the traditional stuff, but some of the alternates were definitely a huge, huge miss. Trent, by the way, has not seen this list before. He doesn't know how I've ranked these uniforms, so he might not agree with me. The people here in the comment section, you might not agree with me, but this is 10 alternates from worst to first. Let me get it up here. Okay, worst to first. We'll go through. We'll start at number 10 with the worst, and we'll work our way all the way to the best. Trent, are you ready for another list here on our fine podcast?
I'm ready, but are the viewers ready?
Are the viewers ready? Man, hopefully I get this one right. You know what I mean? We don't need pitchforks coming. Controversy in the chat coming. We'll see about that, Ethan. Here we go. To me, this is number 10. This is the worst alternate that Michigan has put out over the last two decades.
That's exactly what I was thinking it was going
to
be.
Oh, boy.
This has to be that.
It had to be that, right? Like, listen, there was a part of me that tried to love this when it happened. And, you know, the Victor's Valiant on the undershirt, you know, I thought that was kind of a neat touch. But I remember this game specifically for a few reasons. One, Michigan got their ass kicked. They lost by two touchdowns to Michigan State. This was, let me see, I got my list up here. Hold on, let me pull it back up. This was during 2011 season at Michigan State. So one of the things that happened here, though, was Michigan came out, I think, wearing their traditional road uniforms, and then they went into the locker room, and then before they came back out on the field, they changed into these. It was like a surprise when they came out on the field. I don't know if you remember that, Trent, but
I don't remember that exactly.
Yeah, they were wearing, and unless I've completely lost my mind, the way I remember this is they were wearing their regular uniforms during the warmups. Went into the locker room, switched into these bad boys, came out, and then got their ass kicked by Michigan State. So, you know, the Adidas era, it's tough, man. The stripes, like if you look at some of the uniforms from the '30s, like, yeah, Michigan had the stripes, and you know, that was kind of a thing that they were doing, but this was a tough one to take. I mean, do you agree that this is the worst? I mean, you haven't seen the rest of the list, but this had to be the worst, right?
No, yeah, that's the first one that came to my mind when you were saying the worst. Like, it had to. Whose idea was that to put those stripes on those shoulder pads? Like, it's terrible. I mean,
that's the Adidas life. It's all about stripes, right? That's what they do. And I think as we go through this list, like, that was where Adidas really screwed up, man. They got infatuated with these stripes, and it ruined what could have been maybe some solid, the Bumblebee uniforms, as people used to call them. It ruined what could have been maybe some cool alternates. Let's go to number 9 here. This one was from the, let's see, which season? From the 2012 season, number 9. There we have it. This is Michigan versus South Carolina in the Outback Bowl. Initial thoughts on this one, Trent?
I actually, for whatever reason, I never actually hated these uniforms. They were not, it's definitely not up there in the top five, but I don't know. There's something about it that kind of grabs my attention. I don't know what exactly it is, but I don't hate it.
Well, I'll tell you what grabs my attention is I think it's absolutely awful. And like the helmet, from what I remember, was all matte finish, right?
It was, you know, there
was no gloss on the wing or anything like that. But to me, even when I look at this picture, when I look at the helmet and the pants, the jersey just feels very out of place. It feels like you just tried to plug a jersey in. And for those who are listening in, this is from the, what season did I say it was? 2012. 2012 Outback Bowl. So Michigan's got the maize pants. They got the white top. They've got like a blue stripe on the shoulder with the block M on the shoulder. I feel like it could have worked, but to me, there's just something about this that was off. Maybe it was the way that they changed the helmet, but overall was not a fan of this. And of course, it was a game that Michigan lost. Jadeveon Clowney absolutely destroyed Vincent Smith. So maybe that's playing a factor in it. But for those reasons, this came in at number 9. For me, for all time worst, as we work our way to first here. Let's go to number 8, Trent. Whew, this
now, Steve, to me, the number 9's better than those.
You think number 9's better than this?
Yes, for sure, 100%.
Okay, that's fair. And maybe people out there will agree with you. And again, for people who can't see it, number 8 is the 2014 game versus Penn State. It was a home game for Michigan. This was actually, I believe, the first time Michigan came out wearing all blues. They got the blue top with the blue pants. It's still Adidas. This was a huge, huge missed opportunity for Adidas to finally get something right in 2014. Because to be quite honest, as I'm looking at the picture, it's you know, Devin Gardner is getting ready to throw the ball. They still have the stripes on the shoulders, but the stripes are blue. It's just a different finish. And then they've got this little pattern on the chest that I don't even mind. Where they really lost it was with the numbers. I don't understand the decision to put, if those are solid maze numbers, I feel like it's a pretty incredible uniform.
I probably have a different perspective if that is a solid maze. But yeah, those stripes, they just, it's terrible.
It kind of reminds me of like pajamas or something. Like, I don't know how to describe it, but you mentioned it earlier. It was the stripes thing. And this is yet another example of like, it was almost like Adidas sat back and they were like, how can we get more stripes into this uniform? And it was just a terrible idea to do it on the numbers. It really took away from what I thought could have been an incredible uniform, but a really bad decision there. And for that reason, Trent, that is why the 2014 uniform came in at number 8 on the list. Let's go to number 7, see what did a little bit better than this guy. Traffic cones, yeah, it looks like that. Number 7, the Cowboy Classic from 2012 versus Alabama. Yeah, again, talk about a big matchup to open the year, Michigan versus Bama in Jerry World. Like, that was a big deal. This uniform, initial thoughts on this one, Trent? I mean, it's not loud necessarily. There's not a lot of stripes going on. What do you think about this one at number 7?
So I might be in the minority of Michigan fans, but I really, really like the maze look of things. So this kind of pops to me because you have the maze shoulders with the maze pants. It kind of pops. So far, out of the ones you've placed, this is definitely my favorite one.
All right, so I think we're on the right track here. Yeah, there's nothing about this that I really don't like. And again, we're getting to 7, so we're starting to move from like, you know, worse to like, okay, this one was good. This one was a little bit better. I didn't hate this one. It's got the block M on the shoulders. There's not a ton of stripe work going on. And so overall, I felt like it was a decent attempt by Adidas at a Michigan alternate. So I'll give them a credit for a decent attempt. Let's move on. Unless
the game wasn't decent, though.
The game was not decent. No, the game was an absolute blowout, and maybe that's why this is so low on the list. If they had won that game, I might feel a little bit differently about this combo. Matt Kirby says the yellow is a little too buttery. Yeah, that was a thing during the Adidas era with Michigan. Like, it almost became this highlighter yellow. Yeah. Like, it wasn't the maze that we were used to, and that was a whole issue in and of itself. Let's go to the next one here. Let's see what comes in at number 6. Number 6 is 2011 versus Virginia Tech in the Sugar Bowl. It's once again an Adidas alternate. I felt like this one was pretty, it was safe. There's some stripes, you know, there's two stripes on the shoulders here. You got the block M on the chest, the throwback gray face mask, and of course they've got the numbers on the helmet. I think they wore those for the entire 2011 season, if I'm not mistaken. Trent, what are your thoughts on the Sugar Bowl alternate from 2011 at number 6?
Yeah, it's like you said, it's pretty safe. In my opinion, I actually like number 9 better than these for an alternate.
What was number 9 again?
Number 9 was the
the South Carolina? South Carolina alternate.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Yeah, all right.
I like that more than this one.
We do. I see Nick from the YouTube page. He says this one sucks. Ethan from Facebook says this one should be number 8. The numbers look taped in. Red Wings 44 from YouTube says pass. And the gray face mask is awful, Nick from the YouTube page. So
once again, Chris, you didn't do a very good job.
Not a lot. I thought, you know, given how bad the Adidas era was, I thought this one was okay. You know what I mean? Like, that felt like they played it safe. And your wife says this shouldn't even be on the list, honestly. So I am screwing up royally here, which is kind of what I hoped would happen. Let's move to number 5. Let's get away from this one. Maybe I'll get some buy-in at number 5 here. This is where I think we're going to get a little bit of controversy.
So
we're going to have some controversy a little bit later here in the list, because at number 5, I've got the 2017 alternate versus Florida. Once again, talk about a big week one opener, Michigan versus Florida. I think this one was in Dallas as well, if I'm not mistaken, but this is the first and last time that Michigan wore the all maize Jordan brand uniform. you're a big fan of the All Maize, apparently.
I love these. Yeah, I always want Michigan to wear that, to do this again in the last couple of years. I absolutely love this look.
I don't know, man. Maybe it's the All Maize just felt a little, it felt a little bit too practicey to me. It felt like a practice uniform. I don't really like what they've done with the collar there. You know, the blue stripe around the collar. It's just something, it felt like it, I love Maize. Don't get me wrong. It felt like too much Maize. It felt like a practice jersey. And so I put it pretty high on the list. I've got it number 5, but there's 4 other alternates that I feel like are above this one.
You can't give me 4 alternates that are better than this.
I'm going to try my best, Trent. Well, let's see. Let's go to number 4 right now. Don't hate it. Don't hate it, Trent. I see you shaking your head right now. This is 2011, Michigan versus Notre Dame under the lights. The first night game at Michigan Stadium. Hey, I get it. People hated the stripes. They hated what Adidas was doing. But if you look at what the jerseys looked at like back in the 30s, the block M, the big block M on the front there, that's a throwback to what they were doing back then. The number on the front and even the stripes. If you go back and you look at a lot of the old uniforms, Michigan was rocking stripes on the sleeves. And so for one game and one game only, I thought it was okay. And for this game, I thought it was perfect. And when you combine it with the fact that Notre Dame also came out in the throwbacks with the shamrock on the helmet, you had the referees wearing the throwback hats. Everything about this game was just incredible. It was magical. And maybe I'm a little bit of a victim of how the actual game played out, because when I look at this uniform, I can't help but feel joy. And for that reason, this one came in at number 4. Trent, I know you got a lot to say about this one.
Well, so I ironically bought a jersey like this because of this game.
Me too.
But that's the problem. Like, we're thinking about the game, like this game, what happened, how he threw the game-winning touchdown. Like, we're not looking at just the jersey itself. Because if we're looking at the jersey itself, this is way back there. Way back there. We're talking like 8 or 9 back there.
See, I can't get there. Yeah, I mean, Denard was incredible. When I saw him roll it out and they did the promo for it and what, I was excited. I didn't really hate it. It wasn't until Adidas got carried away with this stripe look that I feel like it really ruined it for me. But for this particular game in this setting, I thought they got the throwback right. Even got the throwback Adidas symbol there on the shoulder. So to me, that's why I put this one at number 4. It doesn't sound like a lot of people in the comments agree with me, though. And I'm having to get used to that, Trent. You know what I mean? I haven't really been a people pleaser as of late with my list. And your wife says typical men, no thought of style when shopping. Rashid from the YouTube page says I'm bugging. The result doesn't have any impact on the quality of the uniform, and on and on and on. So let's just go ahead and move on to number 3. This is where I think I'm going to start to get some buy-in back from the fans here. Let's go to number 3. Look, I don't feel like this is a bad uniform combo. It's again, for people who aren't watching and can't see it, this is an alternate, and this is from the 2023 game against Michigan State on the road. Michigan's wearing the blue pants, blue socks with the white top combo. I think we saw them wear it in the 2021 Big Ten Championship game against Iowa, if I'm not mistaken. We've seen this road combo a little bit. It's not my favorite alternate that Michigan has, but I think it's a solid alternate. It's one that I don't mind seeing once a year. Trent, what are your thoughts on this combo?
I like, yeah. So we can finally agree. Like, I like what you did here. It's a very clean look. I remember when they first came out with these, I'm like, hey, I actually kind of like these, because again, I like the Maize. I like the Maize pants. So when they went away from that, yeah, I'm like, I don't know if I like this or not, but I do like this.
Yeah, and I agree. I'm still a sucker for Maize pants, white top. You know what I mean? But that's traditional, and that's why that couldn't make this list. And so if you were looking for an alternate to that, I mean, the blue pants with the blue socks and the white top, I think it's a pretty clean look. And of course, when you're beating the shit out of Michigan State wearing it, you know, you win 49-0. That certainly helps. So yeah, the result of the game, Rashad, I'm sorry, the result of the game does play a factor. Let's move to number two on the list. This one might be a little controversial, but I think we know where everything's going now. Number two on the list is the All Whites. I remember when these came out. I think it was during the Adidas era. It was Jim Harbaugh's first year when they did the All Whites, the white bottoms and white tops. There was a lot of pushback on it, but there is something so clean about the all white away look that I really, really love. That's why I put it at number two on my list. Trent, are you feeling the all whites?
I don't hate them, but I think, so for me, the all whites would probably go number four. I think the all maize, I like the all maize more than this, and I like the white on blue more than this as well. I don't hate it. It's very clean.
So you take blue pants, white top over white, yes, white top.
Okay. And then I take all maize definitely over this.
Wow. That's wild to me. That's crazy. But a lot of people agree with you. I look at this image of Donovan Edwards, and to me, it looks clean. Everything fits. It just looks like a really nice, complete uniform, the frosty whites. I love here's the thing. A lot of people have said this. Darren is not alone in his thought. Says, lose the stripes and it would be perfect. I don't agree. I like that little stripe down the side, that little splash of maize going down the side. So I would keep the stripe down the side. It sort of matches what they're doing on the arms there, on the shoulders. But yeah, the frosty whites, the all clean whites took number two for me. There has to be, I mean, nobody knows what number one is going to be on the list, right? We have no idea what's coming at number one. Let's take a look at it, Trent. We'll see.
Oh,
there it is. I mean, is there a better look other than, look, I get it. Maize pants, blue top, the traditional look. Like, I think it's going to be hard to top Michigan's traditional look, but the big game blues have really grown on people over the last several years. And I don't think it's a coincidence that it also is Michigan's most successful stretch in a very long time. But to me, these are, it's really hard to beat this uniform combo.
Wasn't it 2021 against Washington? Was that the first game that they did this?
It might be. It might be. Yeah. Under the lights at home.
Yeah. I think I think it was that game, but I remember that announcement. I'm like, what? All blues. They came out under the lights with them on. I'm like, dude, those are sweet. So yeah, I like that. I like that at number one. I think you finally did a good job.
And Trent, for finally did it. Where's the applause button on here? Do I have one still? Let's see, is this one? No, that's not it. No, that's not it either. Damn it, I don't have an applause button on here. You know, for somebody who likes the maize color, something about the blue bottoms with the blue top, it really makes that wing pop, the numbers pop. And yeah, I just think it's a really clean uniform. So that took my spot at number one on the alternates. And you know what? I cheated a little bit here because I did 1A after this one. Couldn't pass this up. I'm just going to go ahead and say it. I feel like this is the greatest uniform combo that Michigan has ever put out on a football field, ever. Any day, any era, any time. You know, some of the old heads out there, and shit, I'm 40, so I'm kind of one of those people. But some of the people that were fans of the game back in the 30s and the 40s and the 50s, they might take exception to it. To me, the Rose Bowl uniform in 2023, it's going to be very, very hard to top this. It was a traditional look with the maize pants and the blue top. They brought the shoulder pads back. I had spent weeks before the Rose Bowl advocating that they bring them back. They ended up doing it. And then you've got, you know, you got the bumper on the helmet representing Michigan being the first program to reach 1,000 wins. You've got the personalized award stickers on the helmet that sort of tell a story of the player's journey. To me, I don't know that we're ever going to see, I mean, shit, we might not ever see a better football game involving Michigan than this one. And I don't know that we'll ever see a better uniform combo than this one. Top to bottom, I thought it was incredible.
Yeah, I agree with you. I really can't add much more to what you said there. It's just, it was fantastic. The shoulder pads up there with the M, it just really made it sparkle. Like, I don't want to say sparkle, but it's like, it just made it go. It just over the top. Like, it was just great.
Trent thought it sparkled. I mean, that's hard. That's probably the greatest compliment you can get. Michigan was sparkling in the Rose Bowl. Hey man, I saw it firsthand. I agree. It was call it sparkles, call it magic, whatever it was, when they came out of that tunnel, and even the little accents, like the guys that were wearing the shields, they had little roses on the decals there, like down sparkled, bedazzled, whatever the hell you want to call it. It was a phenomenal look. And it would be nice if I think that there's some sort of licensing issue with, you know, between Nike and Jordan and maybe the Rose Bowl, which is why you don't have them available yet from the MDN. But I put this out on social media a while ago. I'm like, Michigan would make literally $1 billion if they unleash these to the public. And a lot of that could go towards NIL money for the players who wore them, for the current team now. But there's got to be a reason why they haven't released them. And I think it has something to do with, you know, all the bigwigs out there who need their big cut of it as well. So that's my list of worst to first. It sounds like there was a little bit of controversy, but
yeah, you know, you could have done a better job.
I could have done a better job, but listen, if we're all in agreement, then it's just boring. Then we're just kind of like, yeah, I agree. You got to get a little bit of controversy in there to stir the pot, Trent. Anything that you want to say before you start to get ready for your big trip here to Vegas? And for those who don't know, I'm also going to be taking some time off with the wife as well. We're going to go on a little vacation together. We're going somewhere. We're going a little further south, Trent. We're going to be heading down to the Florida Keys for a few days just to enjoy some mom and dad time. So Trent's going to be in Vegas. I'm going to be down in the Keys. I mean, we're just living the life right now, yeah. Right? This is about as good as it gets.
Living the dream right now.
Living the dream right now. We will be back next year. We will be, or I'm sorry, not
next year.
We'll be back next year, but we'll also be back next week. Talk about the spring game. I've seen some people ask. Yes, Trent and I will be at the spring game. I'm very excited about that. I'll be down the field shooting, Trent up in the press box covering, and then we're going to bring you a post-spring show. We're not sure when that's going to happen, whether it's the night of the game or maybe later on in the week, maybe the following week. But either way, you'll see us back here. We'll both be a little more tan and a lot more broke once you see us again. Appreciate you all.